What a wonderful introduction. But I received a call asking if I would share a few memories of Patrick Rowley's years as governor. I was, of course, honored. But I also found it daunting that I, an 85-year-old woman, was chosen to speak at such an important occasion. But then, I would be in a room full of friends. And what a pleasure it is to talk about the happy years working with Dick Rowley. That time here is a symbol of this extraordinary year when a woman may be elected president of the United States. Because when they held high office, they were great leaders who have done so much for their state and their country. Sadly, leadership in high places is a rare thing these days. While President Bush sits in his office or on his ranch and talks about the do-nothing Congress, it is he who watches the Democrats' efforts to find a way out of this misguided war, to provide health insurance benefits for children, to reduce global warming and our dependence on foreign oil. It is he who is unwilling to discuss, compromise, and seek solutions. That's not leadership. That's dictatorship. In contrast, President Clinton rolled up his sleeves, worked for the Congress, at times Republican control, forged coalitions, and became the most effective president in recent history. In 8 years, he turned the record deficit of $230 billion he inherited to a record surplus of $236 billion. He achieved the lowest poverty rate in 20 years, the largest investment in education in 30 years, and the list goes on, and of course you heard it tonight. That is leadership. In the same way, Dick Rowley's list of great accomplishments are the result of his leadership. Where Governor Sanford brought his pigs to the state house to show his disdain for a legislature controlled by his own party, Governor Rowley rolled up his sleeves, looked the aisles of the legislature, and invited Democrats and Republicans to his office and to the governor's mansion to talk about issues. He found a way to persuade them to support his efforts to be more about STAR programs. In contrast, Sanford's role with the legislature and his poor communication with legislators have resulted in two positive changes in South Carolina. As governor and friend of the people, Dick Rowley led on so many issues. I'll talk about those I know the most about. When he recognized that South Carolina had become the nation's nuclear waste dump, he studied the issue, developed the plan, and worked with Congress and the legislature to help put the plan in place. Together, and the operative word is together, Governor Rowley and the House and the Senate, Democrats and Republicans, created the nation's first historic nuclear waste compact, and it was working. That is, until he left office and incoming Republican administrations undid the compact and returned to the old practice of catering to the interests of the nuclear waste industry. Factually, Governor Hodges got elected to forge another compact, which is still intact, thanks to a great lobbying effort by the conservation community. It probably was a leader in education. When national business leaders sounded the alarm that public education was failing to the detriment of social programs and economic competitiveness, he got to work. He assembled a bipartisan coalition of legislators, won the support of South Carolina business and industry leaders, developed a massive grassroots network, and pushed through the Education Improvement Act. Test scores moved up. Teacher morale improved. But once again, the Republicans who followed reversed course. They removed funding for the successful special programs and put it into the basic education budget with predictable results. Our upward progress stopped. Dick Rowley was a leader in supporting the arts in South Carolina. When he decided that a School of Arts presence would benefit the state, he and his chairman of the state development board, Max Hunter, spent time and energy highlighting and promoting the arts as a way to further economic development and tourism. I remember when they held a one-day seminar in Charleston for out-of-state industry leaders during the Spoleto Festival to highlight the importance of the festival to the economies of Charleston and the state, as well as its enhancement of quality of life, which attracts new industry. If I hesitate, there's just lots of people from reading, and I can't make a speech without reading. Many of you will also remember there were always South Carolina artists at the governor's mansion making music, weaving baskets, or spinning pottery, at all the public events held there. In contrast, Mark Sanford vetoed the budget line item for Spoleto not only once, but twice. In another area of the arts, Dick Rowley and his education aide, Terry Peterson, worked tirelessly to include the arts in the basic part of education. Their efforts working together with the State Department of Education, State Arts Commission, chaired by Sam Tannenbaum, and the legislature made South Carolina a national leader in arts education, used as a model by other states. That was leadership in a state where the legislature had shown little interest in the arts until then. Dick Rowley's leadership was grounded in his uncanny ability to bring people together and develop coalitions to address serious problems and find new ways to improve the lives of all South Carolinians. In this election year, let us hope that the people will wake up and elect more progressive leaders like Dick Rowley and Bill Clinton, leaders who will work on bipartisan solutions to make this country as great as it can be. We cannot afford any more George Bushes and Mark Sanders. We want to work. Thank you for all you have done for our state.